Parshat Matot. Let's get a little bit of a vantage point of where we are. We're in the last stages of our journey. The land has been divided between the tribes. Yah tells Moshe to prepare for his death. And remember from last week, Joshua is appointed as Moshe's successor. Parshat Matot opens with a series of instructions, of mitzvot, of commandments around the power and peril of making oaths, of making vows, of promises that can destroy your life. By providing, though, loopholes that might allow a person to invalidate an oath, the Torah appears to be discouraging the practice without outright forbidding it. And so, why would we be starting with the gospel song, There is a Balm, B-A-L-M, in Gilead? We're about to find out because at the beginning of this week's Parsha, we have the instruction about making vows. And the spiritual There is a Balm in Gilead speaks of a way to ease the pain, as illustrated in a story that you may not know that I'm going to share with you today. But first, the opening line of this week's Parsha. Vayedaber Moshe el Rashei Amatot. Ah, Matot, there's the name of the Parsha. Livnei Yisrael Lemor. Zehadavar Asher Tziva Adonai. Moshe spoke to the heads of the Israelite tribes, saying, this is what Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh has commanded. Ish ki yidor neder ladonai. Ah, there's a word in green. Our word for today is neder, as in kol nidre. Aha, that's where I've heard that word before. Of neder is a vow. Ladonai. All he shavua leesor isar al nafshaho lo yachil dvaro kechol hayotzei mifiv yaase. If a householder makes a vow to Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh, or takes an oath imposing an obligation upon himself, he shall not break his pledge. He must carry all that has crossed his lips. In other words, if you make a vow, you better darn do it. A couple of examples of vows made in Tanakh. The first one is an illustration, Vayidar Yaakov Neder Lemor. There again, Yidur, Nadar, Neder. Jacob then made a vow saying, if God remains with me. So notice in red, these vows take on the structure of if and then, if and then, just like the curses and the blessings. So if God remains with me, Yaakov said, protecting me on this journey that I'm making and giving me bread to eat and clothing to wear, and I return safe to my father's house, then Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh shall be my God. Those are a lot of promises. Those are a lot of things that Yaakov is saying. If these things happen, then this, you will be my God. And I'll let everybody know that Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh is my God. Okay? That's the first example of a vow. Second example is from the book of Shmuel, of Samuel. And raise your hand if you know who said this. V'tidor neder v'tomar Adonai tzva'ot im ra'ah tir'eh. So, and she made this vow, Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh, if you will look upon the suffering of your maidservant and remember me and not forget your maidservant, and if you will grant your maidservant a male child, then I will dedicate him to Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh for all the days of my life. Who is the one who is speaking this? Let me just see your lips moving here, Mary Rita. It is Hannah, right? It is Hannah. And this is an example of a bakasha, of a prayer where the person who is speaking is asking for something in return for getting something. And this always the case of making a vow in the examples that I'm giving you. So that is number two. It is number three that we are headed directly in to the story. Here we go. Vayidar. Oh, I didn't put that in green. I should have. Yiftach neder l'Adonai vayomar. So, and Jephthah made the following vow to God. So Jephthah was a king, and he is at war with various, like a vault, various nations around him. You know, life imitates Torah, does it not? Made the following vow to God. If Im naton titain et b'nei Ammon biadi, if you deliver the Ammonites into my hands, then, all right, drum roll, please. Whatever comes out of the door of my house to meet me on my safe return from the Ammonites shall be God's and shall be offered by me as a burnt offering. I don't know if you're familiar with the story, but it gets much worse from here. Yes, Ellen Weaver, you are waving your head back and forth because this is what happens. Jephthah crossed over to the Ammonites and attacked them, and Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh delivered them into his hands. Victory was his. He goes home. And when he arrived at his home in Mitzpah, there was his daughter coming out to meet him with hand drum and dance. She was an only child. He had no other son or daughter. You can see in that illustration there that he's either saying, Oy gewalt, what have I done? Or something along those lines. Perhaps, my friends, there are times when we either should not make a vow or we should break that vow. Here's what happens next. Vayihi chir'oto ota vayikra et begadav. On seeing her, he rent his clothes. Many of you recognize that word, vayikra, right? We do kriya upon learning of the death of a close family relation, right? Ripping at our garment. So this is what he did when it says he rent his clothes. He ripped his clothes and said, alas, daughter, you have brought me low. You have become my troubler. For I have opened my mouth to God and I cannot turn back. Patsiti, peh. I've opened my mouth to God. Lo uchal lashuv. I'm not able to return. I can't take it back. Okay, so, Nu, you must be wondering what happens in the story. Good question. Well, he makes the vow, as we've just learned, to sacrifice as a burnt offering the first thing he sees upon arriving home. Does he actually do that? The Torah does not tell us. What it does tell us is that his daughter goes into seclusion for several weeks. And the Midrash teaches that she offers herself as a sacrifice, meaning not on an altar, but as a Nazir, as a Nazirite. She is never had sexual relations with a man, and so she is quote unquote pure in that way, and that is what she gives up. She offers herself to God in the same way that Hannah offers her son to God, Samuel, soon to be the prophet Samuel, right? So this is very difficult. This is difficult Torah, right? Later on, the prophet Jeremiah rallies against Jephthah for not remedying the situation. He's basically saying, you know, there was a way out of this. And here is where this famous line comes from. Hatzori ein b'Gilad. Is there no balm in Gilead? Is there nothing to comfort, no way for us to be comforted? Can no physician be found? Why has healing not yet come to my poor people? So we don't know what happened in the story, but we can take some things from it that perhaps we can use. Later on, Shlomo HaMelech, King Solomon, says, if you've shaken hands and pledged, you're snared by the words of your mouth, right? Make a vow. It's ensnared you. It's caught you, right, in a trap. But here's what you can do. Go and humble yourself. Plead with your friend. Plead with your friend. Jumping to more modern times, this is a man I discovered by the name of Ray Edwards. He's a consultant to business, consulting on workplace environment. And he teaches three times when one should break their vows. If that oath requires more than you're willing to give, in other words, sometimes people downplay the scope of the project that they invite you into. They ask you to do something. You say, oh, sure, of course I'll do that. But only after you've made the commitment to work with them do they reveal the full extent of the project. Anybody ever gone through that situation? Yes, many hands have gone up. Here is number two. If that oath requires more than you're able to give, sometimes we just optimistically take on more than we're able to handle. I'm guilty. Anybody else? Yeah, I'm just a guy who can't say no. Oklahoma. And third and last, if that requires something that you shouldn't give and maybe even compromise your values, you realize only later, oi gewalt, what did I promise? I shouldn't do that. I can't do that. I'll be giving of myself in a way that my values will not be represented. You know, we have a way of doing this on a daily, weekly, monthly, and yearly basis. It's called Yom Kippur, or as Reb Zalman of Blessed Memory teaches and reminds us of Yom Kippur Katan, which is really every day, week, month, and year that we have an opportunity to basically rectify this kind of situation. The annulment of vows, kol nidre, is a method of unclogging the spiritual channel as a result of an incomplete vow, whether made to yourself, someone else, or to God, right? So when we don't fulfill our vows, the channel, the tzinor, gets all plugged up. And we need to have a spiritual tool to enable us to unclog that pathway, to return in wholeness. Every day, every month, every year provides us with this opportunity. I know that each one of us here has had that experience, making a vow, saying we'll do something, having to take it back or not taking it back and feeling really crappy about it. And sometimes relationships are destroyed because of it. And so, on this Shabbos day, my friends, may our blessing be that we be mindful of the promises we make and do our best to fulfill them, and be mindful of promises that we make that need to be broken. Shabbat Shalom.